For me, my nutrition journey really started as a wee little kid. I was very uncoordinated, very small, and my dad was like this amazing athlete. He was like a pro baseball player, all this type of stuff. And one day, I heard one of his friends say to him, "Chris, where the hell did Matt come from? You are such a good athlete, and he's just, he could trip over a line on the basketball court." And that was one of the things that like deeply scarred me. And throughout my life, I kind of had just like those athletic jabs of like, he's too small. So that's the thing that kind of really just catapulted me towards wanting to learn how to like eat to be big. You know, that was always my thing. And really throughout most of my life, that just was, you know, pint of Ben and Jerry's at the end of the night, as much, you know, two dinners every time I was going out to a restaurant, just shoveling as much crap in my mouth as I possibly could to try to get big. And it really just didn't work. And I ended up in high school when I got some blood work done at a doctor. I ended up having, you know, my family's history of high cholesterol was presenting in a 14-year-old, and I had these terrible liver and kidney markers in my blood. So it was one of those things where all of a sudden the light was going off like, okay, maybe this is wrong. But at that point, I had no idea what was right. So I made the mistake of going to like bodybuilding.com forums and trying to learn there. And that was probably one of the biggest mistakes. I started taking more supplements and just started eating more food. And I continued to regress. I was still having terrible markers on my blood, and I really wasn't getting that much bigger. But then in 2010, I had a bit of an epiphany. As Daniel mentioned, I was at my CrossFit level one in down in Laguna Hills. And there's about a 15-minute section of a two-day weekend where they talk about nutrition. And they teach you about the zone diet and the paleo diet. And the zone diet is really, it's telling you how to really measure out and figure out how much protein should you eat, how much carbs should you eat, how much fat should you eat. And they break it down into this weird language using something called blocks. And they also told us a little bit about paleo, which told me, oh, so, you know, cheesecake and Ben and Jerry's isn't the key. Like, I also need to eat quality foods like vegetables and good meats, not just, you know, chicken tenders. So that's when I really realized, okay, there's this entire world of nutrition that I want to learn about, and I dove in. So luckily I was in college at the time that I did my level one, and that next year I was able to take my first class in human nutrition at my college. Although I was already a business major, I did an emphasis in complementary alternative medicine, which allowed me to take some nutrition classes and some health related classes, which was great. As soon as I graduated, I did precision nutrition, their level one certification, which is an amazing certification if anybody wants to start, you know, nutrition as their own life path. It's a great starting point. And then from there, I was really just, you know, taking on clients, writing meal plans, which is actually a really bad thing to do if you ever want to take a nutrition path in life. Don't write meal plans for people. They will fail. That was my biggest mistake as a new nutrition coach. And so over time I started really developing my philosophy. And my philosophy is what I describe as diet agnostic. I really do not believe that any one diet is right for everybody. You know, I don't think that everyone should be paleo, or everyone should be keto, or everyone should be a vegan, or, you know, everybody should follow whatever the diet du jour is. I really believe that you just need to improve your eating habits over time. You know, eat as healthy as you possibly can, and really try to control the quantity so that whatever goal you have, you're working towards it. And I really am a big advocate of taking a habit-based approach and realizing you've got hopefully a long life ahead of you, and you've got plenty of time that you can spend changing your habits over that long period of time. So even though I took this habit-based approach and I was having great success with clients, I'm a perfectionist, and there's still always going to be a chunk of clients who don't get results. So I wanted to really minimize that chunk of clients, and I realized that I might have to take a peek under the hood, and I might have to look at people's hormones, I might have to look at some other factors. So I took this this year-long course called Functional Diagnostic Nutrition, which allowed me to start actually looking at people's, I could take saliva, blood, urine, even stool, ship it off to a lab and have them do an analysis and take a look at some stuff under the hood. So that was a really valuable thing for me, for any of the clients who were struggling to see results. They were really hitting a plateau. Take a peek under the hood, figure out what's wrong, address the problems. I did that in about 2015. I've taught quite a few nutrition courses at Paradiso CrossFit since. And so I just love nutrition. Started this company Beyond Macros this about 6 months ago. It's a nutrition coaching company, and I have two coaches working for me, another one in the pipeline, and yeah, this is the life path. So I'm really excited to be able to share this information with you. I really believe that for self-motivated people, they should have a guide for doing nutrition yourself. So I'm really going to try to take today to give you a do-it-yourself approach to nutrition. You know, some people need accountability and some other support, which is why I started a nutrition coaching company. So, you know, wherever you end up falling on the spectrum, there's definitely a solution for you. All right? So I'm really interested to hear what all of you expected to get out of today. So I guess we'll just start over here. And I just want to, I got everybody's names, but repeat to remember. So just say your first name and then briefly, why did you come today? What did you expect to learn?
My name is Brian. I just came to just check out what you can offer. My weight loss, I've been trying to lose weight forever. You know, I lose 30 pounds, but then several months later, I gained all that.
Yeah. Cool. Awesome. Thank you.
Joanna, I've always consistently had some type of activity. I've done personal training. I've always had coaches, but the missing link is always nutrition. So I wanted to see if this could be something that can catalyze me to the right direction.
Awesome. Thanks, Joanna. Thanks, Josh.
My name is Manuel. I just want to get a little more information about nutrition. I want to learn a little bit more because it sounded interesting.
Great. Did you say your name was Amanda?
Amanda.
Amanda. Love your restaurants.
My name is Susie, and I'm the oldest one here. And I would like to make my last few remaining years on Earth productive and healthy and strong. I've been going to a lot of nutrition seminars, etc., and there's so many conflicting messages that they send out. And I wanted to hear your part of it too, especially, I don't know if you touch on inflammation. Does that cause inflammation?
Oh, yeah.
And I'm just kind of collecting information to kind of put things in perspective in my own head.
Great.
Because everybody's contradicting everything.
Yeah.
Yeah,
exactly. That's one of the reasons that I like to talk about nutrition. Today's going to be very, like I said, diet agnostic. I don't want, you know, there's like vegan conflicts with raw, you know, raw paleo, or like, you know, there's all these conflicting diets out there. But, you know, there's definitely a middle road, you know, a very moderate path, and it's whatever works for you. But yeah, we won't be touching on inflammatory foods today, but I will have a little Q&A after, so if you want to ask some questions about it, I'm happy to answer because it's something that I'm educated in. Thanks, Susie.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. And I just kind of want to know, like, am I eating not enough, or am I
eating protein, carbs? Yeah. Cool. Thanks, Annalisa. Awesome. Thanks for coming.
My name is Archie. I just want to understand food in general.
Yeah.
And kind of get to know what it does to my body.
Yeah.
But still be able to enjoy food. So I'm fearful to have that balance.
Yeah. Great. All right. We can snake back this way. Yeah. All right. Nice. Thanks, George.
My name is Nicole. My goal is to lose fat. Nutrition has always been a struggle for me. I'll do good in a few days and then, I just feel good and then cheat meal.
Yeah.
Downfalls from there. So I just
want
to get some tips.
Tips and tricks on how to stay. Cool. Awesome. Thanks for coming. Cool. Thanks. Cool. Awesome. Thanks for coming, everybody. So really the learning objectives that we have for today, first thing that we're going to go over is I'm going to teach you about the three macronutrients, protein, fat, and carbohydrate, and some of the reasons that you need them in your diet for your body, some of the ways that your body uses them, so you can kind of have a little bit of an understanding of the importance of each. So, you know, there's a lot of conflicting information about low carb versus high carb, low fat versus high fat, low protein versus high protein. So I'll give you a little bit of information about why your body needs each of those macronutrients and why it's important to make sure that you have the right amounts. Speaking of the right amounts, we're going to talk about what the right amount of calories for you to eat is based off of your body size, your goal, and your activity level. And we're also going to talk about the right balance of macronutrients and how to calculate those. So this handout that you have is going to help you with those calculations. We're going to talk about what macro counting is. It might be something that you've heard, if it fits your macros, flexible dieting, macro counting, all these things. I'm going to teach you about what it is, why it is a good way of going about things, some of the drawbacks about it, some of the failure points, and how to overcome those. And then at the end, I'll also tell you the difference between like what you should do if you're doing it yourself, and then some of the potential places where you might want to hire a coach. And then I'll open it up for Q&A. Sound good? All right. So, like I said, we've got our three macronutrients, our protein, our carbohydrate, and our fats. Does anyone know what the most important macronutrient is? There we go. I've heard all of them. There we go, all of them. It's kind of like your body, you know? It's like, what's the most important organ that you have? Well, probably not your appendix, probably not your gallbladder, because you can apparently live without those. But it's like saying, what's more important, your brain, your heart, or your liver? Without any of those organs, your body's just not going to function as a system. So each of these macronutrients has a very specific role in the body. There's plenty of things that the body uses. I like to talk about protein first, just because in my experience, most people don't eat enough protein unless they come from a bodybuilding background and they're just constantly drinking protein shakes. But most people don't eat enough protein. And the thing about protein is there's nine amino acids are the building blocks of protein. There's nine of them that your body can only get from diet. And I'll tell you a little bit more about why getting enough dietary protein is important, because your body can essentially manufacture carbohydrates and fats from other sources, but protein you really need to be getting from diet. So protein is really important because It makes up the structures of your tissues. So we got tissue structure and function. So your muscles obviously are made of proteins, but also your skin is made of protein. A lot of the tissues in your body, or most of the tissues in your body, are made up of different sequences of proteins. So really important to make sure that we have enough protein to actually build our body up and maintain our current tissue structure and function. We also have hormones that are made up of proteins, or protein-derived hormones. So for example, melatonin, some of you might take that at night, that's a protein-derived hormone. And then also adrenaline and noradrenaline, those hormones that are coursing through your body when you're going hard on class out here, those are some protein-derived hormones. Our body also uses them for enzymes. Does anyone know what an enzyme is? All right, so it's essentially a thing in your body that like unlocks chemical reactions. So your body is like this giant chemistry experiment going on, and in order to create energy, there's all these chemical reactions happening, and a lot of them are mediated by enzymes. So most of them are protein derived. Another big and important thing about protein is that your immune cells rely on protein. So your immune system, it's very important to make sure that you've got enough protein as well. All right? So tons of reasons that protein is really important. And like I said, there are 9 essential amino acids. So let's say I'm not the best artist in the world, but this is a nice, let's just pretend that's a steak. All right? Nice, juicy steak. All right? You eat that steak. That's you. Beautiful portrait. You eat that steak, and then your body is going to take that steak, and it's going to break down the proteins of the cow that the steak came from into amino acids, which are essentially, this is my nice little Lego piece here, which are essentially the building blocks of protein. So this is an amino acid. So now your body has all of these amino acids. What it's going to do with it is it's either going to immediately use it to build your tissues and structures and whatever protein needs you have, amino acid needs you have, it's going to go straight back to the body. Or alternatively, we have amino acid pools. So we got this nice pool here. It's an above ground pool. All right. The problem with our amino acid pools is that our body's tissues are constantly turning over. There is constantly a need for these amino acids. So it's almost like there's a drain at the bottom and your body is constantly pulling. So the level of your pool is constantly dropping. So that's why you need to make sure that you're eating enough dietary protein throughout the day, is because we don't want our amino acid pools to run out of the raw materials it needs to build back up our tissues. And since you are all people who exercise, exercise is going to break down your muscles, which is going to break down some amino acids, and it's going to mean that you have a little bit higher requirement for amino acids throughout the day in order to build back up your tissues. If you don't have enough protein in your diet, if you don't have those amino acids available, then you might actually lose some of your muscle mass. Because as you're breaking down and you're not putting the raw materials back in to build yourself back up, then your body composition might shift away from good lean muscle mass towards maybe more fat mass, or you know, you might just shrink a little bit. So this is why protein is very important. I like to talk about it first, especially in people who are exercising regularly. Does anybody know why carbohydrates are important? Low carb is like in vogue right now. So I don't think anybody is really talking about why carbohydrates are important, but does anybody know? Energy, exactly. Energy is pretty much the main thing that carbohydrates are important for. Carbohydrates are the primary fuel source of the neediest organ in your body, the brain. So your brain, does anyone want to take a guess? Like, if you were just to sit in bed all day, how much of your daily energy would go to fueling the brain? Well, like what percentage of your daily energy, if you could guess?
40.
A little high. 60. Higher. No, it's lower. Yeah, you were both a little high. 20, exactly, yeah. So, you know, the brain is maybe like a tenth or less. It's even less. It's so small compared to the rest of your body, yet it takes up 20% of your energy needs. So the brain is a really energetically demanding organ in the body. The other major energy needs for all of you is for exercise. So different types of exercise rely on different energy sources. So if you were just to take a nice slow jog for about an hour, your body's mostly gonna rely on fat and a little bit of carbohydrate to fuel that energy system, that low intensity energy system where you could be exercising and still carry on a conversation. For the higher intensity exercise where you're out of breath and you're really going hard or you're weightlifting or anything along those lines, then your body is relying mostly on the carbohydrate that is stored in your muscles to actually give your muscles the energy to do the work that you're being asked to do. So carbohydrates are really important for people who do CrossFit, really important for people who do weightlifting, for people who are just doing like some really low intensity exercise every now and then, your carbohydrate needs are gonna be a little bit lower. But the fact that you come in and you really bust your ass, that means that your carbohydrate needs are gonna be just a little bit higher in order to fuel that exercise. So we'll leave carbohydrates at energy because that is truly why they are the most important. Fats, anybody know some of the important roles of fat in the body? Yeah, it's the biggest energy store in the entire body. So even me being, I'm like, roughly 185 pounds, you know, maybe about 10% body fat. Even me, I have enough energy stored in my fat to just go out and run like 26 back-to-back marathons. If you take a look at the amount of energy I would expend doing that versus the amount of energy that's stored on my body. And that would be without taking in any excess food. So, you know, you've got this massive store of energy in your body, and that is fat. Fat is actually an organ. So as an organ, it also helps with temperature regulation, because it actually is like this nice little insulating layer. But what I believe to be the most important roles of dietary fats are the sex hormones. So the most common ones that everybody knows, testosterone, estrogen, progesterone. Those hormones are all going to be created essentially from fats, cholesterols, and some B vitamins, which are all available in meats. So in addition to the sex hormones here, two other really important things, your brain and your nervous system tissue are all made out of and insulated by fats and cholesterols. So the thing about the nervous system and the brain that's really important for people who exercise is that most strength adaptations are actually the nervous system being able to recruit more of the muscle that you have available to do the work. It's also the nervous system learning how to do the proper pattern of movement. So it's really important to make sure that you're not depriving yourself of fats and depriving your nervous system of the nutrients that it needs to actually be nice and insulated and actually grow and be strong. So brain and nervous system tissue. All right, so does everybody feel like they know at least why each of these macronutrients is important and low versus high in any of them is not necessarily the right path? You know, you need each of them. You can't cut one out and expect to thrive. So now that we have the importance of each of the macronutrients, I want to help each of you understand how much of each macronutrient you need to eat and how many calories you should be consuming per day based off of your goals, based off of the size of your body, and based off of the amount of activity that you're currently doing. So, before we dive into that, the first thing that we're gonna calculate, and you'll see this on your handout, first thing we're gonna calculate is your calorie needs. And when it comes to your body's composition, so when it comes to losing fat, when it comes to gaining muscle, and when it comes to even just maintaining your current body size, but being able to perform your best and improve your performance, it's really important to make sure that you've got the right energy balance. And calories are the way that we measure energy in food, and therefore also the way that we measure energy in terms of how much you're expending. So the important thing about energy balance is to realize that it's an equation. So your energy balance is equal to your energy in, so this is coming from diet, plus or minus, depends on how you look at it, energy out. And this comes from a number of sources. So this is a negative number, so you can almost think of this as energy in minus total energy out. So does anybody know what the many things are that cause your body to use energy? I want to just throw a few out there. Exercise, exactly. So we got exercise. What's that? In a way, yeah. Stress definitely takes some energy. Generally living. There we go. So that we'll call the resting metabolic rate. So this is things like making sure that your body maintains an equilibrium of temperature. So making sure that your body is roughly 98 degrees. This means fueling the activity of your brain, making sure that your lungs can respire, making sure that your heart can beat, all these basic functions that are needed just to keep your body alive and at what's called homeostasis. So this resting metabolic rate, just generally living, makes up the biggest portion of your daily energy expenditure. Exercise, if you are exercising, is going to be the next biggest contributor to your total daily energy expenditure, your total energy out. There's a few other things. Can anybody think of any other things before I just give you the answers? All right, what's that? Yeah, pretty much working. So, you know, even right now, sitting down, you know, if you're moving your leg or, you know, if I'm pacing around right now, I'm not exercising. I'm not consciously coming into the gym, throwing on some exercise clothes and just pacing around up here. So it's not exercise, but I'm still using energy when I'm up here. So this is what would be called non-exercise activity thermogenesis. Long phrase. But after exercise, this is going to take up most of your daily energy expenditure. So these are the things you can think about, like if you're wearing an activity tracker. It's like, how many steps are you taking throughout the day? Thank you. Like, how many steps are you taking throughout the day? No, that's one of the things that would contribute to your non-exercise activity thermogenesis. And then there are other things, but the last one that I'll put here is called the thermic effect of feeding. So as we see here, it's going to take some energy for your body, for your body to then either store it in an amino acid pool or then eventually use it to build up its own tissues, to build your muscle back up, that too takes energy. So for proteins, there is a energy that you spend just to take it in, break it down, and use it. So let's say you take in 100 calories of protein, you might only get 80 calories of that because of the thermic effect feeding. It might take 20 calories to break down, process, and use the proteins that you ate. Whereas with, let's say, a highly processed carbohydrate, like let's say you're eating a cookie, which has sugar and flour that have been really processed, then it's really easy for your body. Most of the digestion has been done via the processing of those foods, so it's really quick. Your body, essentially, it hits your stomach, breaks down, hits your intestines, all of a sudden it's right to the bloodstream, and those carbohydrates are pretty much immediately ready to use. It doesn't take your body too much energy to actually break that down and then use it. It's pretty much just an immediate energy source. So let's say that you have a 100 calorie cookie, you might be getting a full 98 to 99 calories out of that cookie. Whereas if you were to eat, like we've got some quinoa from Fiero's Kitchen, that's a whole grain that's gonna take your body a little bit more energy to break down and then use. So if we take 100 calories of quinoa in, we might be getting only, let's say, 90 calories out of it, for example. All right, so does the thermic effect of feeding make sense when put in those ways? Cool. So really what we're looking to do, if you want to gain weight, you want to gain muscle, first thing you have to get right is your energy balance. So if you want to put mass on, your energy in from your diet has to be more than the energy out from resting metabolic rate plus exercise plus non-exercise activity thermogenesis plus the thermic effect of the foods that you eat. Okay? What's that? So let's say that your energy in is roughly equal to your energy out, then you're going to stay the same weight. If your energy in is less than your energy out, that's when you are going to lose weight. Okay? So the problem with just the weight part of this is that, you know, as somebody who wants to improve the way your body looks and performs, you should be more concerned with your body's composition. So we don't, you know, I always tell my clients, it's not just about seeing your weight on the scale go down, because I tell the story about this one client who, he was kind of bummed. He worked with us for 90 days, which is 12 weeks. You know, usually we expect to see about a pound of fat loss per week. He was looking to lose some fat. He only lost 7 pounds and he was doing everything right. But we had him go get a body composition test done, where they look at, it's pretty much like an x-ray that looks at how much muscle you have versus how much fat you have. He lost 12 pounds of fat, but he gained 5 pounds of muscle. You know, he looked really good at the end of things. So net weight loss was only 7 pounds, but the thing is, he put on muscle because he was eating enough protein, and he lost the fat because he was eating less than he was eating less than he was putting out. So really what the counting of the macros does is, one, it allows us to know, okay, am I eating enough protein to support the muscle mass that I currently have, or to add some muscle mass? Because study after study has shown that even if you put somebody on a weight loss diet, you can still have them maintain their muscle if you have them eating adequate protein. And those studies show roughly in relation to your body weight what those numbers are. So I'm gonna make sure that you know that and you're eating enough, especially if you're going on a fat loss diet. So macro counting is also really important, because we're gonna make sure that you're eating enough carbohydrate to fuel the exercise that you're doing, and to make sure that your brain has some energy so you're not conking out at work and completely crashing and the rest of your life is suffering while you're trying to maybe lose fat. But you know, we're not gonna have so much carbohydrate that it's supporting the fat on your body, you know? And then we're gonna make sure that we're eating adequate amount of fat, especially to make sure that our brain and our nervous system have enough raw materials to make sure that they're healthy and they're supported. We're gonna make sure that we're eating enough of the right fats so that your sex hormones, your testosterone is high enough, because testosterone, whether you're a male or female, is what's known as anabolic to muscle, so it's going to help your body maintain or put on that muscle, and it's catabolic to fat. Catabolic meaning breaking down, so it's gonna help you break down the fat. It's also gonna make sure that for the women, that your female sex hormones are in the right balance. We don't want those to tank out either, because then we can have some issues as well. So that's why the counting of macros can really be a beneficial path to making sure that your body composition is right, but also to make sure that things are going well under the hood, even if you're on a diet to lose fat or to gain muscle.
So if you get cranky, is it lack of carbs or lack of fats?
Probably lack of carbs. Yeah.
Well, on the body,
yeah.
On the
if you get cranky, is it a lack of carbs or a lack of fats? And it's probably a lack of carbs, because it's probably your brain saying, why are you doing whatever you're doing that isn't eating right now? Yeah. So if we go to our handout here, right now we're going to do a little bit of homework. So you can see here, the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to calculate our calorie requirement. The first thing that you need to do is you need to define your activity level. So I put, I pretty much put a little guide for you there. If you're only coming into a few classes a week and you have a desk job and you're not really doing too much of this non-exercise activity thermogenesis, then we'll put you in the sedentary category. Yes, you're exercising, you're not a complete couch potato, but that, this is just for calculation purposes. You're moderately active if you're coming in more than 4 days a week, and you might do some other activities. You might have a desk job, but you know, maybe you're tracking your steps and you're doing a little bit of activity outside of work and exercise. You may be very active if, for example, you're one of the people downstairs that's doing 17-1 for the second time, and you know, you're exercising pretty frequently. That's going to be very active. So then if we look in this chart here, you're going to find your goal. Are you looking to lose fat? Are you looking to maintain your current body weight, which might also mean that you're looking to perform a little better, might also mean you're just looking to like change from a little bit more fat body composition to muscle, but you don't really care about changing your weight. And then are you looking to gain weight? From there, find where you fall on the activity spectrum and just find which of these cells in the table corresponds to your unique situation. All right, so this is going to tell you the number that you're going to multiply your current body weight by in order to find a calorie number. All right, so there is a range here. It is, for example, from 14 to 16. So how do you choose which number you're going to pick? So for example, if you have a little bit more non-exercise activity than your activity category would suggest, then go towards the upper end of that spectrum. If you know that you're the type of person that can eat, and your body's not really going to be affected by it, and you're looking to put on some mass, then maybe you go towards the upper end of the spectrum here. If you have an active job, and you fall into like the or if you fall into the moderate active category, maybe go towards the upper end. But you know, it's really, like I said, nutrition is a refinement process. It's a constant changing of habits. So don't worry about it being the perfect number right now. Just choose one of these factors, multiply your body weight in pounds by that factor, and that's going to be the amount of calories you should eat each day. All right, I'll give everybody a minute to do that. When you're done with the calculation, just look up. As soon as I see most of your eyes, we can move on. Yeah, Susie? Okay. Yeah, so it's... Okay, so what would you say your activity is? Moderately active. Okay, so then you'll multiply your body weight in pounds by 12. Yep, that's all you do. Cool. All right. Everybody got a number? Great. So now we're going to use. Oh, did you have a question? Yeah, what's up?
We come 5 days a week.
Okay.
Our day job is sedentary.
Okay.
What would that be considered?
So then go either, so essentially, what's your goal?
Test.
Oh, so, okay, so what's your goal?
Maintenance.
Okay, so let's say.
Because you said maintenance includes, like if you wanted to lose, like, reduce your body fat percentage, that would still be maintenance, or is that weight loss, fat loss?
It might be fat loss, it might be maintenance. So for you, I would say that you should probably multiply by 14, since that's.
Oh, since it crosses over.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But that's considered moderate.
It depends. If you're happy with the current size of your body, but you just want to add a little bit of muscle so you have some muscle tone, then you might want to be in the maintenance category. And then just go towards the lower end of it. Oh. Susie? Well, the thing is, it's relative to your body size. So if you're larger, you're probably going to have a little bit more muscle mass, maybe. But the thing is, if you feel like your current, so if you feel like your current body composition has shifted more towards fat than muscle mass, go towards the bottom end of the range that you have in whatever cell you're at. Yes, because your body is going to have less need. You have less tissues that are going to be needing energy. So when you're smaller, your body has, because calorie is just energy. So when you're smaller, your body has less of a need for energy. Whereas if you're larger, you just have more tissues that have more of an energy need. So that's why we do it relative to the size of your body. It's a good question. So he's asking if you need to be at a caloric surplus and you definitely need to gain fat in order to put on muscle. And then what was the second part about the carbohydrates?
And if not, like, if you don't need to be, then kind of where do you push yourself as far as the percentages to get yourself to where you're putting on muscle, but you're changing composition and losing fat?
Yeah. So really the most important thing for muscle maintenance and muscle gain is protein, and we're going to get there in a minute. Ideally, if you want to maximize your muscle gain, like you were really trying to massively bulk up, then yes, you want to be at a calorie surplus, and yes, with the muscle mass, you can expect to be putting on some fat. But you can still, on either a maintenance or a fat loss protocol, put on muscle, especially like if you're a newbie, for example, you're brand new to weightlifting, you're pretty much guaranteed if you're weightlifting and you're eating enough protein to be putting on some muscle. As you become a little bit more experienced, it's a little bit harder. You're really fighting for smaller gains in muscle. But yeah, if you're just looking for some body recomposition, it depends on which direction you go or you really want to go in first. You could lose fat, you could gain muscle, you could go in the maintenance category, make sure you're eating enough protein and see how your body composition shifts. But you know, that's something where, you know, you need to do a little bit of self-experimentation and also think clearly about what your primary goal is. And you know, are you okay with putting on a little bit of fat right now to gain some muscle that, and you'll eventually lose the fat? It depends on a number of factors. Yeah. All right. So let's move on here. Write down what your calorie goal is going to be. We're going to use this now to actually calculate the rest of your numbers. All right. So next thing we're going to do here is we're going to calculate your protein needs. If you only get two things right, if you eat the right calories to reach your goal and you eat the right amount of protein, you're going to be okay. Fat and carbohydrate, ideally we want to dial in the rest of the macronutrients as well, but the bulk of the body composition changes that you're going to see are going to come from getting the right calorie balance, the right energy balance, and making sure that you're eating adequate protein for your activity level. So we're going to do two calculations here. We're going to take there's really two ways to calculate your protein needs. One, you can do it as a percentage of your total calories. And then two, and this is the way that I like to do it, is calculate it based off of your body weight. So like I mentioned, there's these studies that show that even if you put somebody on a fat loss diet, if you have them eat the right amount of protein, that they're going to either maintain or gain some muscle mass. So the number seems to be around 0.82 times your body weight in pounds. That seems to be the magic number for being able to at least maintain your muscle mass while you are on a fat loss diet and you are somebody who exercises. So first thing I want you to do is if you are looking to gain mass and you're active, multiply your body weight times 0.82. You can use a calculator on your phone. What's up? Yeah, 0.82. Yeah, times your body weight in pounds. So if you're a 100-pound person, it's 82. If you're 200, it's 164. So that's if you're active and you want to gain mass. If you are active and you want to improve your performance and maintain your weight, go between 0.82 to 0.9. If your goal is to lose fat and you're active, you should go with a little bit more protein, because with the less calories, you're gonna have a little bit more muscle protein breakdown during the exercise. I always like to err on the side of caution and go between 0.9 to 1 gram per pound of body weight. So based off your goal, do that quick multiplication. And then the next thing that you're gonna end up multiplying is you're gonna take your total calories, and then if you're looking to gain mass, multiply it by 0.25. If you're looking to maintain your body comp, or maintain your body weight and improve your performance, multiply by 0.3. If you're looking to lose fat, multiply your calories by 0.35. Multiply the total calories that you got by that.
By the number we got right now.
By the calories that we got in the last section.
Okay.
Yeah. And then when you do the multiplying by the smaller number, divide it by 4. And then write that down.
So divide it by 4?
Yeah. So take your total calories, multiply it by either 0.25, 0.3, or 0.35, depending on your goal, and then divide that final number by 4. Your total calories, yeah, multiply it by the decimal and then divide by 4. And then write those two numbers down. All right, so as you're finishing up here, in grams per day, so the first number that you got, that's gonna be your minimum protein intake per day. So if that number is larger than the second number that you calculated, you need to go up to the first number. So let's say, for example, if you calculated in grams per day, you multiplied by your body weight by 0.82, and it comes out to 165 grams, but then you're like, okay, I'm looking to lose fat, and I multiplied my calories by 0.35 divided by 4, and that came out to, let's say, 140. You need to increase your protein up to the higher number there, the first number, because that's the minimum amount of protein that you're going to want to eat in order to maintain or gain muscle.
So regardless, you divided by 4.
Yeah, I didn't divide by 4.
What's that?
I divided by 4.
Oh, so you had a big number? Yeah, yeah. Sorry, what was that?
So regardless, you divide it by 4.
What do you mean?
So I got that.
Okay.
So then I multiply that by that.
Yep, and then that, and then you...
Divide it by 4?
This one you don't divide by 4, the second one you do divide by 4. Yeah. All right, so a quick example here. Let's take 200-pound person that needs to eat, let's say, 2,000 cal. Just for ease of calculation. For the first number, if they are multiplying by 0.82, then they need 164 grams of protein per day. For the 2,000 cal, they're looking to, let's say, what would they be doing? Gain mass, so times 0.25, so we've got 500 divided by 4 is 125 grams. So, for this person, this is the minimum amount of protein they would need in order to gain or maintain muscle while they're on this diet. Since this number is 125, it's less than the 164, they need to go with this number. So this is the floor for how much protein you should be eating. If the second number you got is higher, if it is higher than 164, that's fine. Then that number is protein intake that you can go with. Yeah, just thinking about this as the minimum amount of protein that you should be getting per day.
Should I be eating more than the second number? So no more than the second number?
It's not that it's no more than the second number. It's that the second number is it's easy to think about your macronutrient balance in terms of eating 30% from protein, 30% from fat, and, you know.
But it's not like you should not eat less than the first number, but no more?
Yeah, you should not eat less than the first number.
Could you eat more than the second number?
You could. I mean, it's just, yeah, you should, your target should be whichever number. Yeah. All right. Everybody got a number? Is anybody still confused about the calculation? Okay, cool. So, like I said, if you get your calorie balance right, if you get your protein intake right, those are gonna have the biggest impact on your body composition. The next thing that you can kind of layer in to make sure that you are making sure that you have enough energy from carbohydrate to fuel yourself and you're eating enough fat is to make sure that you get a good balance here of the fat and protein. So the next thing you need to determine is kind of what type of person you are. You need to know, are you a hard gainer like me? The type of person who can just shovel Ben and Jerry's two dinners from TGI Fridays and have a cheesecake at night and still not put on a single pound? That would be somebody who's a hard gainer. You know, you just really struggle to put on mass. If you are what's called a mesomorph, that means that, let's say that you're training and you're eating, you're gonna really put on some muscle. Let's say you go the other way, and you know, you're not really lifting many weights, you're not really training, you're still gonna be, you know, a relatively muscular looking human being, you're just not going to be massive. Yeah?
Does age affect that?
The body type? It's a metabolism thing. It's an approximation of, yeah, if you've been a hard gainer most of your life, consider yourself a hard gainer. Yeah. The mesomorph is kind of in the middle, and then the easy gainer, it's like, if you just look at the outside of Randy's donuts, you're gonna put on some weight, all right? So, based off of that, we've got these macronutrient ratios here in the table. So you're gonna determine, you're essentially going to find where you're at and you're going to circle your macronutrient ratio.
So
nice and easy.
I was like a hard gainer.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. If that's the type of person you are. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. 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 The thing is, you can adjust these macronutrient ratios over time. This is we're finding a good starting place for you, and we'll talk about how you can make adjustments from there. All right. So the reason that we're doing these calculations is I want you to start actually keeping a food journal and tracking your food. So does anyone here have familiarity with the app or website MyFitnessPal?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So the reason that we're doing these percentages here is because MyFitnessPal, unless you buy the premium version, only allows you to put in macronutrient percentages, all right? So has anyone not used MyFitnessPal or not familiar with MyFitnessPal? Okay, so MyFitnessPal is a app and a website that you can put the amount and type of food that you put in. It's got this massive database of food and food nutrition facts. You put in the amount and type of food that you've eaten. It's throughout the day, and it's gonna keep a running track of how many calories were in the food that you ate, how much protein, how much fat, and how much carbohydrate. So it's a food journaling service. So if you keep track throughout the day, it's going to add up and it's going to tell you, you've eaten 2,000 calories, 200 grams of protein, 400 grams of carbs, whatever. So we're now going to essentially take these numbers, and you can actually change your calorie and macronutrient goals in MyFitnessPal. So if you don't currently use MyFitnessPal, my recommendation is that you install the app on your phone or you register on the website and start keeping a food journal for the next week, just your normal eating habits, your normal eating patterns. Don't change anything yet, and just see how close that the calories you eat per day are, the protein that you eat, the carb that you eat, and the fat that you eat, just intuitively, based off your current habits, see what that shakes out to, and see how it compares to the numbers that we've calculated for today. After a week of taking a look at what your normal eating habits are, change your calorie and macronutrient goals in MyFitnessPal. You just go to the settings, to the goals, and then you can change the calorie and macronutrient goals. Put in the calorie number that you calculated and put in the macronutrient ratios that you've chosen here. And then start to see how you can change your daily eating habits to shift towards the right macronutrient ratio and the right caloric intake. So for example, you essentially do an audit on yourself. So after, let's say, the next week, starting tomorrow, you're going to log your food all the way through Sunday. Then Sunday night, after you're done eating, take a look back at your food journal for the week and see, okay, you know, for me, I've been eating, let's say, closer to this 125 grams instead of this 164 grams of protein. So I know that I need to add more protein-containing foods to my normal eating routine. So I, you know, if the only thing that was wrong for me is that I wasn't eating enough protein, then what I could do is I could say, okay, I need to eat about 40 grams or more protein, and then I gotta figure out what foods contain 40 grams of protein. It might be, let's say, 6 ounces of chicken. It might be 2 scoops of protein powder. It might be 4 cups of beans. And then, you know, play with your MyFitnessPal, find the day, for example, where the only thing that was off was the protein, and then just try adding in 2 scoops of protein. See how it affects then your calorie intake. Add in, let's say, 6 ounces of chicken. See how it affects your calories and the fats. And you can kind of play around and think about, okay, you know, the biggest thing for me is I'm not eating enough protein. I need to change my habits around eating enough protein. So you can use MyFitnessPal to identify and kind of play around with what protein sources are going to fit within my macronutrient ratios, fit within the right amount of calories to maintain the energy balance I'm looking to achieve, what fits into the puzzle. And really just focusing on one habit change at a time. So you might identify, okay, I need to get about 6 ounces of extra chicken per day. So if I need 6 extra ounces of chicken per day to make everything fit perfectly, then like, how do I make it convenient to make sure that I've got that 6 ounces of protein per day? Well, you know, you might want to, if you're busy through the week and you don't really have time to cook, then maybe your habit change becomes on Sunday, I need 6 ounces per day times 5 days during the work week when I can't cook. So I need to make sure that I'm cooking about 30 ounces of chicken, or picking up a rotisserie chicken that's going to have about 30 ounces of chicken on it. And I need to cook that on a Sunday so that I can put that into my daily eating habits. So that's really the process you want to go through with this, is take a week, log all your food, don't really change anything, see what things shake out to, and then play around with, do a little audit and play around with, okay, what foods can I remove from my habits, or what foods can I add to my habits to just get me a little bit closer to this ideal macronutrient ratio that I'm looking to achieve. And then from there, think about, okay, how do I make the rubber meet the road? So, okay, yes, I need 6 ounces more chicken per day, but how do I make that work within the context of my life? You know, how do I make, rather than just think about it, know I need to do it, and skip it, if that makes sense. Cool? So yeah, that's pretty much the process that I want you to go through. The biggest issues that you'll run into with macro counting, the first one is just learning like the macro language. So starting to understand what foods contain what balance of macros. So, you know, for example, you know, we've been told for so long like peanut butter is a good source of protein, but really it is fat that has some protein. Or, you know, nuts, they're a great source of protein, but really they're just a lot of fat with some protein. Or beans, for instance, you know, beans are a good source of vegetarian protein. Yes, for a vegetarian, they are a good source of protein, but they're mostly carbohydrates and they have some protein. Even meat, you know, you might think, oh yeah, meat's just a great source of protein. But yeah, meat's a great source of protein that, you know, depending on the content of the meat, it probably is going to have a lot of fat as well. Eggs, great source of protein, but they're going to have as much fat in grams as they do protein in grams. So you're going to start to have to learn kind of the macro language. I interview all of my clients after they're done, and one of the standard questions I ask clients after they're done working with us is, if you could give people that are about to start a nutrition program one piece of advice, what would it be? And I would say that the overwhelming majority of people say that if you just put your head down for the first 2 to 4 weeks and you just weigh and measure everything and start to develop your eye for what portion sizes and food looks like, then after the first month, it almost becomes second nature. You can go out to dinner and you can look at what's on your plate and you can way more accurately estimate what that food is. You know, you can tell like, oh, that's probably about, you know, 6 ounces of chicken sitting on the plate and like a cup of sweet potato or something along those lines. So you start to be able to visualize what your portion sizes need to look like. So even if you're not weighing, you take a month to weigh, you develop your eye. Even when you're not weighing, then you're really going to have a much better concept for what food needs to look like for you. All right, that makes sense. And as you start to pay attention when you're keeping a food journal, you're going to start to learn, okay, what is the fat and the carbohydrate and the protein content of the foods that I commonly eat? And it's going to be a really good practice, and it's going to give you essentially that knowledge that you need in the long term to sustain good eating habits. All right? So learning the macro language is really important, and the way that you do that, weigh and measure some food in the first month, keep a food journal, pay attention while you're keeping the food journal to what the content of food is. The second issue with macro counting is it doesn't really account for nutrient timing, so like the timing of carbohydrate and protein and all these things around your workout. For the most part, the most important thing, like I said, calories and protein. From there, getting the rest of your macronutrient balance throughout the course of the day is important. And then, you know, kind of like a secondary thing to do would be to improve the timing of the nutrients that you have, and also to improve the quality of the foods that you're eating. So you could eat, you know, there's people out there, there's, you know, researchers who have done experiments where half their calories come from Twinkies and the rest come from nutrient-dense foods, and they just get the calorie balance right and they lose weight. So, you know, you can, that's one of the benefits of the macro counting and just making sure that you hit the right calories, protein, fat, and carbs is, initially, if you have really bad eating habits, you can still potentially fit some of your vice foods into the mix, and you get the quantity right, you kind of have the motivation from still being able to change your body with some crappy foods in there. But then, like I said, you've got a long life. We take a habit-based approach. Initially, if you change your quantity, and then you take the steps towards, okay, I don't want to have, you know, 3 donuts per day taking up most of the calories and the macronutrients that I need to eat each day. So I'm going to start removing those once I've started to see some progress, and, you know, once I want to make that change, or, you know, adding in some high quality foods over time. But dialing in the quantity, you're going to start to see some changes in your body. You're going to start to see some improvements in your performance. And that's what's going to keep you motivated in the long run to continue to make nutrition changes and to continue to want to seek out different ways that you can make changes. And nutrient timing and improving quality are two of those ways that macro counting, or if it fits your macros and flexible dieting, might not address initially, but there are areas that you can go down the road once you've got quantity dialed in. Cool. The other issue too is that, you know, although I say I'm diet agnostic, counting your macros and calories, it is still technically a diet in a way. So the problem with diets is that 90% of diets fail. But the reason that most diets fail is because generally they represent a major departure from your normal eating habits. So let's say that I come to you and I hand you a meal plan and you're like, oh, okay, you know, I can do this meal plan. It might have a grocery list for me, but then, you know, all of a sudden you're like, oh shit, I want to go out to lunch with my friends and this meal that I have isn't on the menu at the restaurant. So you've departed from your meal plan, and you know, you, if you start to get off the rails there, then you know, you might lose a little bit of motivation, you might get off track. And then let's say that this meal plan is a 6-week meal plan, you know, it's a 6-week diet plan and it's a complete change up from your normal habits. Well, once this is over, what do? Do you just go back to week one and repeat it over and over? Generally, it doesn't represent something that's sustainable in the long run. So by taking a habit-based approach and using your own eating habits as a template to make changes from, then you know, you're taking what's natural for you and you're just making one little change. You're putting all your energy and all your focus into making that one little change, and but it'll become second nature. Within a month, 2 months, maybe even a couple weeks if it's a really simple change, it'll become second nature. And then you can think about what the next habit to change is. And over time, you're gonna have changed that bundle of habits, that bundle of eating habits that you are, and it'll be a much more sustainable path. So, you know, this is really a springboard for a sustainable diet plan. Cool? All right. So this represents how you can take a do-it-yourself approach to nutrition. There are definitely some circumstances in which it makes sense to hire a coach, which is why I started a nutrition coaching program in the first place. I would say that the first and most important is the accountability factor. And the thing about accountability here is that, you know, it's one of the great things about having a nutrition coach. You know, you might be calculating your calories now, your macronutrients now, and you might be really good, but, you know, if you're doing it on your own, you don't have anyone to be accountable to, who's really going to know, who's really going to care if you eat a little bit more, you know, and each day you might eat a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit less, a little bit less. And, you know, you might not be making perfect progress towards your goals. When you have the accountability of a coach, somebody who is actually checking in on what you're eating and making sure that you're on track with your goals and with your habit changes, it's really effective. And the thing is, I always tell people, you don't necessarily, like, this is one of the great things about having a coach, and there's a lot of great things about having a coach, but, you know, you can team up with somebody else in this room, become friends on MyFitnessPal, and, you know, you can at least create accountability if, you know, you're not ready to hire a coach. You can still get that accountability in other ways. But it is one of the great things about having coaches that you know the person you're accountable to is also an expert. So that's kind of the second great thing about having a coach is you've got this second set of eyes. So like I said, the big part of this process is you're going to take a week, you're going to eat your normal eating habits, and then you're going to take a look back and you're going to audit, and you're going to figure out what are some of these habit changes that you can make. When you've got a coach, when you've got somebody who's an expert and a second set of eyes looking at this, you know that that person's going to be able to identify some really high impact changes that you can make and make sure that you're making the right changes. You know, you might be a little bit unsure about whether or not the change you're making is the best change that you can make right now. The thing about having a coach is you've got somebody who's worked with tons and tons and tons of people. They've seen what's worked for people. And so you have somebody that's actually going to be able to identify, okay, what's the highest impact change that you can make right now? Let's make that change. Okay, that's second nature. What's the next highest impact change you can make instead of just throwing spaghetti against the wall and seeing what sticks? All right? Yeah. The third thing that's great about a coach is they can help you overcome plateaus. So one of the issues with doing it yourself is knowing when to stop. So let's say that you are on a weight loss plan, you've calculated your calories, your protein, you're doing everything right now, you're losing weight, all's fine and good, all of a sudden you hit a plateau. What do you do? That's the point when having a coach is important, because the coach is gonna essentially know when you should stop your fat loss track and maybe go to a maintenance track for a little bit. Because the thing is, I want everyone to know this before they leave this room, you should not stay on a calorie deficit or a calorie surplus for more than, I don't let my clients do it for more than 90 days. Because the thing is, let's say that right now, you know, you haven't dieted at all, you know, you've just been doing your normal eating habits and your daily energy expenditure is 2,000 calories, you wanna lose weight, we drop you to, let's say, 1,600 calories. Pretty soon, your body is gonna do a bunch of things to lower the energy out equation, maybe in subconscious ways, you do less non-exercise activity thermogenesis, you're walking less, you're being a little bit more lazy subconsciously, maybe you skip a few more days at the gym. That's your body trying to conserve some energy because all of a sudden it's only getting 1,600 calories. So over time, theoretically, your daily energy expenditure might have been 2,000 calories 45 days ago, but after fat loss, it might start creeping towards that 1,600 mark. You might hit a plateau because all of a sudden, your daily energy expenditure, your energy out, has gone to 1,600 calories. That's the point where you're gonna want to have a coach who's gonna help you get onto a maintenance plan without gaining all the weight back. But for if you're gonna do it yourself, really limit yourself. You've got 90 days to lose, 90 days to gain, and then you wanna try to find your maintenance level and you wanna get back there. You wanna stay on a maintenance plan until you know things regulate, and then if you still have some weight to lose or you still have some weight you wanna gain, then you can go on that plan again. But that's where it really helps to have a coach to help you overcome those plateaus, know when the stop points are, and to really, you know, if you've got long-term goals, and that's really one of the four things here, if you've got long-term goals, it's really nice to have somebody who can give you, you know, what does the plan look like over the next year? You know, it might be, you know, like, for example, if you're like, I want to lose fat, but I also want to gain muscle and improve my performance. It's not that those goals are necessarily mutually exclusive, but you can't optimally go in all directions at one time. You need to know which direction to focus on at what time. So if you've got some long-term goals over the next year, for example, you know, you want to lose your body fat, but then you want to put on some muscle, and then you want to improve your performance and do great in the 2018 CrossFit Open, that's when it really helps to have a coach who can come up with a plan for you in the long term and help you create and execute that plan. It's also really nice just to have somebody to ask, you know, what's a good meal suggestion? I'm getting sick of, you know, rice, beans, chicken, and broccoli, or, you know, what type of meal prep activities should I be doing? So there's a lot of benefits to having a coach, but at the same time, if you educate yourself and you take a smart approach to doing it yourself, it's definitely something where you can make a ton of progress. It's really just a matter of being diligent about tracking, staying accountable to yourself, staying accountable to somebody else, and sticking to the plan, and really understanding you have a long time to change. You have a long time to change habits. Don't try to rush it and do it all at once. If you try to rush it and do it all at once, then it becomes a diet, it becomes a crash diet, and you are going to crash. It's not going to be sustainable. You might lose 20 pounds for the next 2 months, and then all of a sudden, you're right on the path to gaining it right back. So
probably if you were like 90 on and 90 off, 90 days on, like whatever goal, and then maintenance.
Yeah.
And for 90 days, back to wherever.
Yeah, pretty much. You know, it's not, for some people, their metabolism might not drop too much. They might be like very resilient, and they might only need 60 days on a little maintenance phase, or they might only need 45 days before they can lose maybe 5 more pounds. But yeah, you definitely want to take it in cycles. So does anybody have any questions about what to do going forward? All right, awesome. Well, I am definitely interested in hearing, for everybody that's going to take a do-it-yourself approach, I'm really interested in hearing if you make some amazing progress. I want you to email me and let me know what you did and what your progress was. If you're interested in getting coaching, my company Beyond Macros has amazing nutrition coaches. And you can also email me to get more information as well. And I also know that Coach Mark is doing some nutrition services as well. So you've got plenty of options for nutrition coaching. You've got all these people in this room for accountability buddies. So you've got a lot of resources out there for you. So again, if you make some amazing progress using this information, email me, let me know. I will be super stoked to hear about it. If you are looking for some nutrition coaching, you can also email me for more info. And I know Daniel said that there is some food from Fiero's Kitchen that we have here. He also has a postage scale. So one thing that we can do right now is we can actually go through, take somebody as an example, and take a look at eyeing out some food quantities and taking a guess at what it weighs. So we can head over there right now. Oh, sorry, Susie, what's up? Oh, that's a great question. Are all proteins equal? The answer is no. So there are a variety of different ways that protein quality is measured, and they essentially measure protein quality by the what's called the limiting amino acid. So like I mentioned, there are 9 essential amino acids, the ones that your body cannot actually produce. It can only take in from diet. So each food is going to have varying degrees of each of those 9. So for example, beans are going to be very low in an essential amino acid called methionine, whereas rice is going to be very high in it. So beans, if you were just only to eat beans alone, they're going to have a pretty low quality protein. But with like plant-based proteins, if you combine them, so you combine rice and beans, then all of a sudden the amino acid profile is a little bit better. There's studies that show that, for example, like bone broth protein is kind of this new buzz food that's going on out there. I'm seeing it everywhere, this bone broth protein thing. A very recent study that came out in January of 2017 mentioned that collagen, which is the type of protein that bone broth protein is, has a essentially a protein quality score of 0 because it has very few of the essential amino acids. It has a lot of proteins in it, a lot of amino acids in it, but they're not really the ones that your body can't already make itself. So getting meats. Meats are gonna mostly have all of the amino acid that you need, seafood, all those things. You can, if anyone in here is a vegetarian, you can combine plant-based sources to make a complete amino acid profile, but you really need to make sure that you're being intelligent about combining the right proteins. What's that? I'm not really a holy grail protein kind of guy. For me, it's like, you know, on a daily basis, for me, I'm eating some rice and beans, so I am getting some good plant-based sources of protein. I've done a food sensitivity test, and I am very sensitive to whey. I could have told you that just based off the way it made my stomach feel by taking it, so I do a plant-based protein powder as well. But I also eat probably about 3/4 pound of meat per day or seafood. So, you know, I'm getting a variety of protein sources throughout the day. Susie.
So the powder protein isn't as effective as good as meat?
Yeah, so Susie asked if the powder protein and meat are the same in terms of quality. So in terms of the amino acid profile between let's say a whey protein and beef, whey protein is actually gonna have more of the essential amino acids that you need for building muscle than beef, slightly more. It's gonna have a higher protein score, but the problem with that is you shouldn't just go out and just be going protein, 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 protein in terms of the powders. Because the thing that is missing from the protein powder is the sources of fat that are important for like sex hormone production, for example, some of the other nutrients that only meat is gonna have. So the powders are gonna be nutrient deficient, whereas the meat is gonna have like fat soluble proteins and things like that in it. And then the meat's also gonna have more of the B vitamins, and B vitamins are really important for things like energy transfer and the production of those sex hormones. So although yes, the protein score is higher, to look at it in the larger context of things, meat is very important for a number of other reasons. What's that? There's a bunch of different types of fat. You've got your unsaturated and your saturated fat. So omega-6 and omega-3 fats are your essential fats, just like amino acids. They're the two fats that your body can't manufacture and has to get from diet. The thing is, omega-6 fats are in everything, which is why people take fish oil and do omega-3s, is because omega-3s are a little bit harder for us to get from foods that are commonly available to us. So it's good to put an emphasis on getting good omega-3 fats. Yeah. Yep.
So I just wanted to
Uh-huh.
Do you guys, when you do blood testing, do you do something where you say, okay, these are the proteins that are
the most important? Sorry, can you speak up?
When you test people, you look under the hood of the test set, do you guys test to see which proteins you'll be able to? I've seen some companies that are testing people's blood.
Yeah. Yeah. Interesting. I don't know about the transferability of like going with hemp and egg protein, but I know there's But yes, there are tests that you can do that are going to look at essentially the amino acids in your blood, and then you can determine essentially, you know. The thing is, that's not really a test that I personally run. There's a guy locally named Chris Talley who runs some really comprehensive panels, and I know that his tests actually look at some amino acids in your blood as well, and he can give some recommendations based off of that. And then
another question was this: do you, when you test also on the blood, do you kind of develop a macro profile based on
Yeah, so I do, based off of, one of my flagship tests is stress and steroid hormone test. So it's going to look at, for example, your cortisol throughout the day. It's going to look at all of the different steroid hormones that you have. And so based off of what I'm seeing there, I'll usually kind of adjust people's macronutrient balance a little bit. But the thing is, it doesn't make a huge difference. Like, I might adjust people's carbohydrates, but a lot of times when I'm seeing that, I might know, like, you know, oh man, like, your steroid hormones are tanked out, take a look at their diet, realize that they're not eating enough fats, and then I might adjust from there. But if people are eating a good moderate macronutrient ratio and I see those type of things, I pretty much know that there's probably some other lifestyle factors or environmental factors that we need to address. Yeah. Susie? It's okay. No, so that's a good question. So not all calories are equal, yes. So that's where the thermic effect of feeding comes in. So, you know, one calorie from quinoa is going to be processed different than one calorie from white flour, because white flour is highly processed, so your body is going to have more of that available. Whereas with quinoa, since it is a whole grain, it's got some fiber, it's going to take a little bit longer and more processing to break down into the simple carbohydrates that your body can use, then less of the energy from quinoa is going to be available to the body. Any other questions before we check out the food? Yeah, so that's a good question. George, right? Yeah, so George was asking, let's say that 2,000 calories per day is what your goal is, and then one day, let's say you go on a binge, you eat 3,500 calories, then what do you do the next day? Do you adjust? Do you eat less? Do you eat the same? And there's a bunch of different points of view on this. There's some people who will say, like, yeah, so throughout the course of the week, you know, if your goal is 2,000 calories, you should eat 14,000 calories throughout the course of the week. So adjust there. The thing is, my personal belief is that if you binge on 3,500 calories and then the next day you drop to 1,400, that represents a disordered eating pattern. So I generally recommend, because I take a habits-based approach, that you just go back to what's normal, that 2,000 calorie habit on the second day, because that's going to help reinforce the good habits. If you go into a pattern of eating a bunch more, compensating the next day, eating a bunch, compensating the next day, that's going to put you into a little bit of a disordered eating pattern, and it's also going to make it harder to form those good habits at 2,000 calories. Yeah, good question.
So we obviously recommend real food over supplements. I used to be heavy on the shakes, stuff like that.
Yeah.
I started seeing results until I started actually eating more food and less of the shakes.
Yeah. Yeah, so he's asking if you should kind of go more towards real food versus shakes. And my perspective on that is supplements should supplement your diet. So I have tons of clients who, you know, they're large people. You know, they're probably, you know, I've got one guy who's 245 pounds, so he needs to, he's losing fat right now, so he needs to eat like about 240 grams of protein per day. And so for him, you know, he's a big dude, so he can eat a lot of food. But the thing is, 240 grams of protein is like over 2 pounds of meat if you were looking to get it just from meat. So the thing is, for him, you know, it makes sense to just eat what feels normal in terms of meat, which is actually like he crushes seafood, crushes meat, and does really well with diet, but it only gets him to like 200 grams of protein per day. And then we have him supplement the remainder. So just thinking about, you know, these shakes as being supplements, if you can get real food, if you can get whole food, go that route, but then add in the supplementation where it makes sense.
So eat naturally, like quantity-wise, and then if your numbers are a little bit off, supplement with supplemental.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Cool. Any more questions? Awesome. Well, thanks for coming out, y'all. Let's check out this food thing and